हेलो एवरीवन, सो इन दिस वीडियो वी विल टॉक अबाउट द पेजेंट मूवमेंट्स इन इंडिया। पेजेंट मूवमेंट इन इंडिया वॉज अगेंस्ट ऑल द सप्रेसिव प्रैक्टिसेस बाय द यूरोपियन प्लांटर्स और द बिग जमींदार्स, लाइक हाई रेंट्स, आर्बिट्री इविक्शंस एंड अनपेड लेबर इन जमींदारी एरियाज। द गवर्नमेंट ऑल्सो लिवाइड हैवी लैंड रेवेन्यूज। द मूवमेंट ऑफ द पेजेंट्स वर मैसिवली अबाउट द लॉसेज ऑफ इंडियन इंडस्ट्रीज वेन द ब्रिटिश इकोनॉमिक पॉलिसी resulted in the ruin of traditional handicrafts and other small industries, leading to a change of ownership and overburdening of agrarian lands and massive debt, also improvisement of the peasantry. The other causes were unfavorable policies. The economic policies of the British government used to protect the landlords and the moneylenders and to exploit the peasant. This was practiced to gain more favor for British by the big and powerful classes of the society. The peasants rose in revolt against the injustice of many occasions. One such revolt was seen in 1859 to 62 and known as Indigo Revolt. In order to increase their profits, the European planters persuaded the peasants to plant indigo instead of food crops. The farmers were discontent growing indigo because low prices were offered for growing indigo. Also, the crop was not lucrative and planting indigo decreased the fertility of the soil. The peasants suffered at the hands of the traders and the middlemen, and the anger of the peasants exploded in 1859 when they were led by Digambar Biswas and Bisnu Biswas of Nadia district, and they decided not to grow indigo and also resisted physical pressure of the planters and their lathials or retainers. They were backed by the police and the courts, and consequently, the peasants launched a movement for non-cultivation of indigo in Bengal. The peasants involved in Indigo Rebellion were supported by the press and the missionaries, and Harish Chandra Mukherjee, a Bengali journalist, described the plight of peasants in Bengal in his newspaper, The Hindu Patriot. Also, Deenbandhu Mitra, a Bengali writer and dramatist, in his play Neel Darpan, depicted the treatment of Indian peasantry by the indigo planters. Neel Darpan was first published in 1860, and his play created a huge controversy, which was later banned by East India Company to control the agitation among Indians. The government also appointed an indigo commission and issued an order in November 1860, which notified that it was illegal to force the ryots to cultivate indigo. This marked the victory of the peasants. Pabna movement took place in 1870s to 80s, and in large part of the eastern Bengal, landlords forcefully collected rents and land taxes, which was often in hands for the poor peasants. These peasants were also prevented from acquiring occupancy rights under the Act of 1859. In May 1873, an agrarian league was formed in Yusuf Shahi Pargana of Pabna district of Patna or eastern Bengal. Rent strikes were organized, funds were raised, and the struggles spread throughout Patna and on the other districts of the eastern Bengal. Also, the struggle was mainly legal resistance and little violence. The discontent continued till 1885 when the Government of Bengal Tenancy Act was passed and enhanced the occupancy rights. The struggle was supported by Bankim Chand Chatterjee, R.C. Dutt, and Indian Association under Surendranath Banerjee. The Deccan riots of 1875 were directed against the excesses of Marwari and Gujarati moneylenders, and the ryots suffered heavy taxation under the ryotwari system, and the land revenue was also raised by 50% in 1867. Practice like social boycott was practiced by the peasants in 1874. The ryots organized a social boycott movement against the moneylenders, and they refused to buy from the moneylenders' shops and cultivate their fields. Also, the barbers, washermen, and shoemakers refused to serve them. This social boycott by the peasants spread rapidly through the village of Pune, Ahmedabad, Solapur, and Satara, and was also transformed into agrarian riots with systematic attacks on the moneylenders' houses and shops. But the government succeeded in repressing the movement, and as a conciliatory measure, the Deccan Agricultural Relief Act was passed in 1879. According to this act, the farmers could not be arrested and imprisoned if they were unable to pay their debts. But the nature of the revolts changed after 1857. Now the peasants emerge as the main force of agrarian movements, fighting directly for their own demands, and the demands were centered almost wholly on economic issues. Also, these movements were directed against immediate enemies of the peasants, who were the foreign planters, the indigenous zamindars, and the moneylenders. The struggles were directed towards the specific and limited objectives and redressal of particular grievances. Also, colonialism was not the target of these movements. It was not the objective of these movements to end the system of subordination or exploitations of the peasants. The territorial reach was limited and there was no continuity of struggles or long-term organizations, and the peasants developed a strong awareness of their legal rights and asserted them in and outside the courts. After the arrival of Gandhi in India in 1915, powerful movement was seen in Champaran in 1917. The peasantry on the indigo plantation in the Champaran district of Bihar was excessively oppressed by the European planters and were compelled to grow indigo on at least 3 of the 20th part of their land and sell it at a price fixed by the planters. In 1917, Mahatma Gandhi reached Champaran and began to conduct a detailed inquiry into the condition of the peasantry. He defined the orders of the district officials for leaving Champaran. In June 1917, the government appointed an inquiry committee with Gandhiji as one of the members. Also, the enactment of the Champaran Agrarian Act of 1918 freed the tenants from the special imposed levied by indigo planters. Second successful struggle was the Khera Satyagraha of 1918 under Gandhiji's supervision. It was chiefly directed against the government, and in 1918 the crops failed in Khera district of Gujarat, but the government refused to remit the land revenues and insisted on its full collection. Gandhiji, along with Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, supported the peasants and advised them to withhold payment of revenue till their demands were met. The Satyagraha lasted till June 18 and the government conceded to the demands of the peasant. Towards the end of 1921, there was a movement called Ikka movement took place, and it was a result of the peasants' discontent resurfaced in some of the northern districts of United Province like Hardoi, Behraich and Sitapur. The issues which were involved here were high rents, 50% higher than the recorded rates. Also, oppression of the tikhatdars, the in charge of the revenue collection, and practice of share rents. The meetings of the Ikka or the unity movement involved a symbolic religious ritual in which the assembled peasants vowed that they would pay only the recorded rents but would pay it on time. They will not leave when evicted and will refuse to do forced labor. Also, give no help to the criminals and abide by the panchayat decisions. The grassroots leadership of Ikka movement came from the Madari Pasi and the other lower caste leaders and many small zamindars. By March 1922, severe repressions by authorities brought the movement to an end. In 1921, Moplas were the Muslim tenants inhabited in the Malabar region and where most of the landlords were Hindu. Their grievances centered around the lack of security of tenure, high rents, renewal fees and other oppressive exactions. Also, the Mopla movement merged with the ongoing Khilafat agitation, and Mahatma Gandhi, Shaukat Ali and Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad addressed the Mopla meetings. Many Hindus were seen by the Moplas to be helping the British authorities, and the anti-government and anti-landlord movements acquired communal overtones. Also, communalization isolated the Moplas from the Khilafat and the non-cooperation movement. The movement was called off by December 1921. The enhancement of the land revenue by 30% in Bardoli district of Gujarat by the British government led to the organization of a no revenue campaign by the Bardoli peasants under the leadership of Vallabhai Patel. A woman in Bardoli gave Vallabhai Patel the title of Sardar, and the unsuccessful attempts of the British to suppress the movement by large-scale attachment of cattle and land resulted in the appointment of an inquiry committee. The inquiry committee, as a result of the Bardoli Satyagraha of 1928, came to the conclusion that the increase had been unjustified and reduced to the enhancement to 6.03%. The All India Kisan Congress or Sabha was founded in Lucknow in April 1936 with Swami Sajanand Saraswati as the president and N.G. Ranga as the general secretary. A Kisan manifesto was issued and a periodical under Indulal Yagnik started. The All India Kisan Sabha and the Congress held their sessions in Faizpur in 1936, and the Congress manifesto, especially the agrarian policies for the 1937 provincial elections, was strongly influenced by the All India Kisan Sabha agenda. There was another movement known as Tibhaga movement, where Tibhaga literally meant three shares of the harvest. The Tibhaga movement was the sharecroppers movement, and the tenants were demanding 2/3 of the produce from the land for themselves and 1/3 for the landlord. Basically, from this principle, the name Tibhaga movement came across. It was a militant campaign initiated in Bengal by the Kisan Sabha, which was the peasant front of the Communist Party of India in 1946 and 47. And at that time, the sharecropping peasant had to give half of their harvest to the owners of the land. The demand of the Tibhaga movement was to reduce the share given to the landlords to 1/3. As a result to this agitation, the then Muslim League ministries in the provinces launched the Bargadri Act, according to which the share of the harvest given to the landlords would be limited to 1/3. But the law was not fully implemented. One of the prominent features of this movement was that there was a large-scale participation of the women. The landless and the poor peasant women formed fighting troops called Nari Bahini and took a front rank role in defending the gains of the movement and in countering the repression of the state. Telangana movement proved to be the biggest peasant guerrilla war of modern Indian history, affecting 3,000 villages and 3 million population. The princely state of Hyderabad under Asajahi Nizams was marked by a combination of religious linguistic domination, total lack of political and civil liberties, and grossest form of force of exploitations by Deshmukhs, Jagirdars, Dorars in the form of forced labor and illegal extractions. The uprising began in July 1946 when a Deshmukh thug murdered a village militant in Jangaon Taluk of Nalgonda, and soon the uprising spread to Warangal and Khammam. The peasants organized themselves into village sanghams and attacked using lathis, stones, slings and chili powder. Also, they had to face brutal repression. The movement was at its greatest intensity between August 1947 and September 1948. The peasants brought about a rout of the Razakdars, the Nizam's stormtroopers. Once the Indian security force took Hyderabad, the movement fizzled out. The Telangana movement had many positive achievements to its credit. In the villages controlled by guerrillas, vethi and forced labor disappeared. Also, agricultural wages were raised, illegal seized lands were restored, and steps were taken to fix ceilings and redistribute the lands. Measures were also taken to improve irrigation and fight cholera. An improvement in the condition of women was witnessed, and the autocratic feudal regime of India's biggest princely state was shaken up, clearing the way for the formation of Andhra Pradesh on the linguistic lines and realizing another aim for the national movement in this region. Thank you for watching this video. I hope it was helpful for you. For more videos, please subscribe our channel.